Yes, ma'am.
Right. Thank you so much. A very good evening to all of you. It is my proud privilege to invite all of you and to welcome all of you to the fourth distinguished lecture and to this August-September evening. We have with us a very eminent academic, Professor Jatindra Kumar Naik. Professor Naik was educated at Ravenshaw College and Merton College in Oxford and retired as Professor of English from Utkal University in 2016. Professor Naik is a translator, literary critic, columnist, editor, and academic from Odisha. He has translated several works of Odia literature into English, including Jantra Ruddha, a novel by Chandrasekhar Ratha, as Astride the Wheel, for which Professor Naik bagged the 2004 Hutch Crossword Book Award. And this award is for Indian language fiction translation. He also won the Katha Translation Award for his English rendering of Tarun Kanti Mishra's short story As the Descent in 1997. Professor Naik is a co-translator of the English translation of the Odia novel Chhamana Athagunta, written by Fakir Mohan Senapati, which was first published in the USA as 6 Acres and a Third. He has also translated into English Fakir Mohan Senapati's autobiography as Story of My Life. An academic par excellence and a distinguished translator, Professor Naik, at present, is a member English Advisory Board of the Sahitya Academy. We welcome you, sir, on behalf of the Postgraduate Department of English, Burhampur University. I welcome all the participants and I welcome our revered speaker, Professor Jatindra Kumar Naik. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Das. I express my deep gratitude to you and your colleagues for giving me this opportunity to share a few true thoughts about a writer whom I revere, a writer who still continues to speak to us even 150 years after his death, or more, I think nearly 200. He died in 1918, so nearly 100 years after his death. So I'm really glad to be speaking to so many students and so many of my distinguished colleagues today. And this subject is dear to my heart. And I'll try to be I will try to say things about Fakir Mohan Senapati which might illuminate aspects of his oeuvre, aspects of his prose fiction. So I'll begin by briefly summing up Fakir Mohan's life and times. This is unfashionable in a theoretically driven times, but gradually you are now beginning to move back to a world where a writer and his life were extremely important for reaching a certain conception of his work. So Fakir Mohan's life is so fascinating that without really taking into account, it's very difficult to form a general idea about the layered richness of his work. So when we talk of Fakir Mohan Senapati, we actually talk about a very large part of the 19th century. He was born in 1843, 40 years after the British took over Odisha, occupied Odisha in 1803. And he died in 1918, the year in which the First World War came to an end. So you could think of his life coinciding with the 19th century in Odisha, the second half of the 19th century in Odisha, and the first two decades of the 20th And this period is extremely important in the history of Odisha, because during this time, I think the society, the economy, the culture of Odisha got transformed under the impact of colonialism. British colonial rule, I think, completely transformed the economy, the society, and culture of Odisha. And Fakir Mohan was not only a witness to this process of transformation, he was also a very key participant in the process of this transformation. So we can see his life in terms of a tremendous transformation of a whole society. He was not only a witness, but he was also a very great interpreter of this process of transformation. So I'll just talk about some major incidents or major events which unfolded during his life, so that we can get a general idea about how he distilled this experience, this very rich experience, into undying prose fiction or deathless prose fiction, which is as great as anything that's written anywhere in the world. So I said that he was born in 1843, and then, of course, he wasn't very rich. I think he had a very checkered career, poverty-stricken childhood, had to give up his studies. I think he had very little formal education, worked as a child laborer in the shipyard. Balasore at that time was a very prosperous town, and he worked in the shipyard and noticed how he was a witness to the decline of Balasore as a very prosperous city. The mouth of the river Budabalam got silted up, and the maritime trade of Balasore, I think, declined, and Balasore lost its prosperity. And then he was a witness again to the devastating famine that ravaged Odisha in 1866, which decimated the population of Odisha. So he was a witness to that. And he participated in the agitation to save Odia language from the threats that were being posed to it. So he became a textbook writer, vigorously participated in the freedom, print culture, introduced the first printing press to Balasore and started writing textbooks and brought out a newspaper. And then for a time he taught at a school, and finally he became a Dewan, a very important administrator in the feudatory states of Odisha. So he served 5 or 6 feudatory states as Dewan and acquired valuable experience of life in the feudatory states of Odisha. He worked with the British officials and also with the feudatory chiefs. And during his Dewanship, 2 or 3 tribal uprisings took place. He nearly lost his life in one of them. So the point I was trying to make all this while during this brief synopsis of his life, it was a very rich experience. And this rich experience was distilled into, I just mentioned, the rich fiction that he came to write later. But this life also tells us, this brief synopsis of his life also tells us, that Fakir Mohan was a witness to an era, a society in transition, a society in a state of turmoil, a society that was actually getting transformed under the pressure of colonial rule. And he was, again, a witness to the encounter, the conflict between the old and the new, between tradition and modernity, between the tribal and the non-tribal. So Fakir Mohan's life encompassed a period of great turmoil in Odisha's history, and he was a witness to many changes that were overwhelming, that were transforming a backward state, an agrarian state, which was actually disintegrating under the pressure of certain new policies, new laws. And whenever a society changes, under the pressure of alien laws, alien education system, alien revenue system, but in 2 particular areas this change is very deeply felt. One is law, the other is education. And the, of course, these two have something to do with the most important area of life, land. Because the word for students, I must point this out for the students who are participating in this webinar, that the very word colonialism actually is derived from the Latin word colere, to till. So colonialism is centrally concerned with land. Somebody possessing your land, dispossessing you from your land, changing land related laws, and in the process, a series of displacements take place. So in all Fakir Mohan's fiction, you will notice that land occupies the central place. And if you take Chaman Athagun, for instance, his most important novel, the title, very title itself, is land, and land measure in very exact terms. I'll come to that later. But the point I was trying to make is that during Fakir Mohan's time, under a new colonial dispensation, land revenue policies were changing. And land was becoming a commodity, a sellable commodity. And all this was happening because the colonial state was trying to maximize its revenue. And in the process, in many areas of life, changes took place, irreversible changes took place. And in order to create a class which will enable the British to implement these new laws, you had to introduce a new education system. The older education system had to be replaced. So in Fakir Mohan's fiction, like in the fiction of many of his contemporaries and later, you also see, you come across the emergence of a Western educated elite, and particularly the emergence of a class, new class of lawyers. In almost all Fakir Mohan's novels, at least in Mamu and in Shaman Athagun, in Prayaschit, the law court comes to dominate. Lawyers come to dominate the action. So to sum up, Fakir Mohan was dealing with a society in transition, but he's not exploring it like a sociologist. He's not exploring it like a historian. He is exploring it, depicting it like a creative writer that he was. And all creative writers, all great novelists, all great writers of fiction, when they confront social transition, when they confront social turmoil, they try to express it, they depict it, understand it, make sense of it through plot, through setting, and primarily through characters. So all great writers have created great characters who sum up a period, who embody, who make their characters embody social processes which historians and sociologists, statisticians can never help us do. So Fakir Mohan, like all great writers, like Dickens and Hardy, with whom he has been compared, tried to create characters who embody, who symbolize certain processes of social change which his contemporaries couldn't fully understand. Let's take the example of, say, the first Odia novel, Padmavali, which talks about a love story unfolding against the colonial rule. And the characters are characters from romances, and the narrator is slowly acquainting the reader with the new colonial dispensation, which is complicating matters, but ultimately it's actually a story of love between a young girl and a king. Take Vibhasini, which was written in 1888. These are the predecessors of Fakir Mohan's realistic novels. And these novels, Vibhasini is also set in the time of Maratha misrule of Odisha. And again, it's primarily about an unrequited, unfulfilled love story. The center of these narratives is actually a love story. And in the backdrop, you have a social turmoil and political turmoil. But these do not find expression in terms of vividly realized characters. They are still very much embedded in, rooted in the romance tradition. But Fakir Mohan's fiction represents a powerful, a visible break with that romance tradition. Like all great novelists, he initiates something absolutely new. Even, for instance, the novel which deeply influences him, it is written in English, Bengal Peasant Life, written by Reverend Lal Bihari Dey. I think it was published in 1874 in English and in Bengal. And Fakir Mohan mentions this novel in his autobiography, so he must clearly have read it. Even when he's rewriting this novel, he's completely transforming it. That novel, Bengal Peasant Life, presents the story of Govinda Samanta, a peasant, traces it from birth to death, and shows how he becomes a victim of unfair or cruel land revenue policies. That's all. This character actually doesn't embody larger historical processes, doesn't illuminate a world order changing. Only great writers can do it. I can immediately, the novel that springs to my mind is Turgenev's Fathers and Sons. The central character is actually embodying the notion of nihilism. Bazarov, the character, actually is representing a tendency that was actually challenging a whole of Western European civilization in the 19th century. So only a very great writer can make his characters embody and symbolize very, very, very complex historical and social processes. So Fakir Mohan is trying to do that. How does he do that? So I will now come to, I have already given you a picture of the society which were changing in fundamental ways. New laws were being introduced, a new education system has been introduced, new land laws are being implemented. So a new administrative system has been introduced. So all this have generated great sense of uncertainty, and people really didn't know what to do. So they had options. Most of the writers or most of the members of the elite had a very simple option. You support the past, you feel nostalgic about an order that has completely been replaced by another, or you wholeheartedly embrace the new and completely reject the older order. But like all great writers, Fakir Mohan rejects both the options. So in his fiction, what you find is an attempt to dramatize, an attempt to make sense of, an attempt to express through characters and settings and plots this complex negotiation between the old and the new, the complex negotiation between tradition and modernity, and he refuses to give you very simple answers. I will make this clear when I go to the texts themselves. So let me begin, for instance, with some of his stories. So let's take Patent Medicine as a story. Very famous story. Fakir Mohan's Patent Medicine has been adapted into stage plays, radio plays. I think even school children know about it, and we know of this play as, or we approach this play as a farce. An alcoholic husband is brought to his senses by a wife who beats him with a broom when he comes back home gloriously drunk. So this is a very entertaining story. Everybody likes it. But Fakir Mohan is trying to do much more in it. He's not interested in simply a story of a husband, an erring husband, or a husband who has strayed from the path of virtue to be reformed through an extreme measure, like a wife, Hindu, dutiful Hindu wife, beating her husband with a broomstick, which is an ultimate sin, which is the ultimate sin from a certain point of view. But Fakir Mohan actually goes far beyond this. If you read this story carefully between the lines, in fact, this story is actually an adaptation of a Japanese play translated into Bangla by Tagore's brother, Satyendranath Tagore, but Fakir Mohan adapts it into an Odia short story. Now, what does he do with this story? Those of you who have read this story know that there are three different points of view from which this central character is seen. The central character is Sulochana, the wife, this long-suffering wife of this alcoholic, debauched husband. So there are three points of view on this lady. One is the point of view of the servant, who is scared of this very powerful housewife, who is very authoritarian, knows her mind. And the other point of view is that of her husband. The husband sees her as someone who is not very attractive. He actually breaks her name into two parts, Sulo and Chuna. Solo and Chuna. Solo is something that grows in village ponds with which crowns are made for the goddess. Solo, water plant. And Chuna is out of his cakes are made. So he said, your mistress is Sulo Chuna. Solo and Chuna. Someone is very unattractive. Someone who is not, from an erotic point of view, from the husband's point of view, not very attractive, not worthy object of desire. And who does he admire? He admires a prostitute, Usman Tara. So Usman Tara is more attractive. This prostitute gives him askar rum, and she gives him very good food, and doesn't give him bland food which his wife serves him at home. And then there is the narrator's point of view. The narrator calls her Sulochana Devi, the daughter-in-law of a zamindar who has transferred all the property to her because he knows that his son is a profligate scoundrel who will dissipate the wealth. So you have these three points of view. After she gives him this beating by her broomstick, he gets reformed, and both of them now go out every day in a horse carriage on a tour of the city. They are the companionate, the marriage is a companionate marriage once more. There is conjugal bliss. And the narrator introduces something very interesting. Now, this husband, the former drunkard, reads Utkal Sahitya and Mukura. So actually the story becomes an allegory of regenerated, reformed elite of Odisha. That this way, an elite which had become degenerate, an elite which had grown irresponsible, an elite which had made its hedonism, make it deviate from the path of duty, its social responsibility, now has been able to regenerate itself. So a story which is on the surface can be so entertaining, can be so funny, actually contains a very important allegory, an allegory about a regenerated elite, 19th century, early 20th century elite of Odisha. Fakir Mohan, in a way, is actually dramatizing ways of regenerating this debauched elite. You can also take many such stories. Fakir Mohan's attitude towards education is very complex. In some stories, he can be very, very harsh towards people who have received Western education, like the famous story of Dr. Munshi, where he is very, very harsh. Post peon requests his boss to give his son a job because he has received a modicum of Western education. And once his son becomes a postmaster, he throws his father out of his house because he thinks that he's unlettered, he's unsophisticated. In fact, he asks his peon to throw him into a bush. So this is one way in which Fakir Mohan looks at Western education. At the same time, in a story like Rebati, he fully sympathizes with this young village girl's desire to receive education, modern education. But think of his story, Randipo Ananta, the widow's son or widow's brat, where the noblest character in this story is someone who refuses to receive education. He lays down his life for the greater good, but he refuses to receive education. Fakir Mohan's attitude towards education is not a very simple one. Like all, as I told you, a highly complex response to education. Depending on the context, Fakir Mohan can like Western education or dislike Western education. So there is no simple-minded rejection or adoration of Western education in Fakir Mohan. So all this actually, in fact, one should read. I think I will encourage students to go through a fantastic poem which Fakir Mohan wrote, which sums up his sophisticated, highly nuanced response to colonialism. This is called Moh Hata Bahura. I have just returned from the marketplace. So this is a long poem, and the whole marketplace is actually full of various shops selling different kinds of education, different kinds of learning. So he sees colonialism, colonial rule, as a marketplace, which is dispensing, selling different kinds of knowledge. Some shops sell Western literature. He says, here you can buy Shakespeare, Byron, Wordsworth. And there you can buy Kalidas, Bhatti, but that shopkeeper looks very ungainly, very unattractive. The students don't go there. And he has this funny thing to say about Western education. He sees that traditional education is being despised, rejected, there are no takers for it. And then Western education has many takers. And then he concludes the poem, very fascinating poem, with the saying, if you read Western texts, you receive Western education, your body will become thin and your intelligence, buddhi, will grow very coarse. Deha heva saru buddhita mota. So you have this highly conflicted, complex response to Western education, Western culture. It's never a simple rejection. It's never a wholehearted acceptance. So Fakir Mohan has to be approached very carefully. Like great writers, he can't be put into a pigeonhole. He can't be put into a pigeonhole and defined once and for all. So there is a plurality of interpretations. That's why I called my lecture Perspectives on Fakir Mohan, and these perspectives keep changing. As Fakir Mohan gets translated, more and more of his works get translated into English, new critical perspectives are available on him from non-Odias, from people, sometimes people from Latin America, people from America, people from Britain, like John Bolton has his own perspective on Fakir Mohan. So Fakir Mohan Senapati can accommodate, his fiction can accommodate changing perspectives, and how the changing perspectives keep illuminating different aspects of his fiction, I will try to demonstrate by looking at his most famous novel, Samanarthagunth. So, like I said, Samanarthagunth is unique in Odia literature because no Odia novel, no novel I think in India, perhaps in the world, has a plot of land as its protagonist and as its title. So here, earlier novels, the novels written earlier, had titles like Padmavali, Vibhasini, Saudamini, Anathini, like that. And even Fakir Mohan, so earlier, later novels are titled Mamu, the maternal uncle, Lachama, which is the name of the heroine, and Prayaschit, which is again a moral expiation. Obviously, it does a strong moral content. So Mati Ramanisa, Kalindi Panigrahi, Kidamati, Nityananda Mahapatra, Paraja, a tribe, and Gopinath Mahanti, Andha Diganta, Nilasala by Surendra Mahan. So it's unusual. You think of this title, it's an extremely unusual title. I don't think any novel bears such a title. It's not just land, it's a plot of land which has been measured carefully, measured meticulously. And I just mentioned that colonialism is centrally concerned with land. Land as a source of revenue, and later land as a commodity that can be sold and purchased. Land that can belong to an individual like a commodity so that he can sell it. This is something new under the colonial British dispensation. Land has become a commodity. That's why Fakir Mohan's title for his first novel is a meticulously measured plot of land. Obviously, Fakir Mohan is talking about the commodification of land, land becoming a sellable commodity. And once land becomes a sellable commodity, it becomes highly unstable. We live in a world where every day somebody is selling a plot of land, somebody else is buying a plot of land. So dispossession, it's not just about land becoming a commodity, sellable commodity. It's also about dispossession. Somebody owns it, somebody dispossesses it of, somebody takes it away from it. So whenever one talks of land, one also talks about displacement and dispossession. So Samanarthagun, one perspective on Samanarthagun is it's a moral fable, that here is this appreciative grasping money lender who takes this piece of land from a poor weaver couple and finally dies a pathetic death. This is one way in which, this is one perspective. And generally speaking, people read Samanarthagun, 6 acres and a third, from this perspective. Story of poetic justice. But look carefully at the action that unfolds in this novel. Many good characters die. Bhagya goes mad, his wife, Sarya, poor woman, dies. The very good character, the moneylender's wife, she also dies. So all these people die, they are good people. So where is poetic justice? So Mohini Mohan Senapati, Fakir Mohan Sen, was a brilliant academic and philosopher, challenged this perspective from the very beginning. In his preface to the collected works of Fakir Mohan Senapati, or I think the first, in some edition of Samanarthagun, he says that lightning falls, the lightning doesn't discriminate between a church, a temple, and a poor man's heart. It falls everywhere. It doesn't discriminate among its victims. So it's not a question of poetic justice. This perspective is highly distorted and misleading. So Mohini Mohan Senapati suggests that we should look at Samanarthagun in terms of something else. What is that? That nature abhors excesses. British justice doesn't punish Ramachandra Mangaraj because he defrauded a poor weaver couple of their land. Because from the point of view of law, British law, everything was perfect. Everything was in order. So Ramachandra Mangaraj has done something immoral, but not illegal. So this new distinction between morality and legality is something new. So why did he suffer? Because his greed got the better of him. And he took away the cow, Meta, which the weaver couple owned illegally. So in purely technical terms, he has done something wrong. Therefore, he was sentenced to 6 months of imprisonment. That led to his undoing. That is Mohini Mohan Senapati's perspective. But I think even this is limited. This takes us some distance, but doesn't take us very far. So let's take Notabara Samantharaya's perspective. He's an outstanding critic of Fakir Mohan Senapati. And he was the first critic to point out that when we look at Fakir Mohan Senapati's prose fiction, we soon see them as stories or plotted narratives, giving us aesthetic pleasure at the end of when we rise from a reading of these texts. These actually dramatize 200 years of history of Odisha. It's a brilliant insight into Fakir Mohan's prose fiction. And you can see that Fakir Mohan is doing something far more important than other novelists of his time or even after him. How does he justify his position, Notabara Samantharaya? He says, take Lachana. It deals with Maratha rule, 1751 to 1803. Then Samanarthagun, the period dealt with is 1830 to again another 20, 30 years. Mamo was the end of the 19th century. And the early decades of the 20th century are dramatized in Prayaschit, when at the center of the narrative you find Western educated Odias who are now inspired by the thing that they're very enlightened. They have read Darwin, they have read Mill, they have read Spencer, and now they think that they can easily ignore the precepts of their own scriptures and take decisions on their own, and disaster follows. So that's another. But Notabara Samantharaya convincingly demonstrates that Fakir Mohan was interested more than, in something more than, much more important than mere storytelling. He was trying to illuminate larger historical processes. Now, let's look at Somana Arun from this point of view. How does he illuminate larger world historical processes in a story which is apparently, on the face of it, is about a small village near Kendrapada in Cuttack district in those days, involves a petty moneylender, a poor weaver couple, a town lawyer. So, villagers, peasants, how could a novel like that illuminate world historical processes? If you look at the novel from a little more nuanced perspective, you see that this novel is dominated by a narrator. The characters are not important. It has a very dominant, garrulous, loquacious narrator. He digresses. He's constantly dominating the narrative and engaging in a negotiation with, dialogue with the reader over the shoulders of the characters and constantly linking events unfolding in the narrative to very large historical processes. And you see, the whole novel is about a series of displacements. Nothing stays still. Take the Zamindari of Fatehpur Sarsang. The title of the Zamindari, name of the Zamindari is Fatehpur Sarsang. When the novel begins, it is in the hands of Ramachandra Mangaraj, a moneylender. But the narrator informs us that only recently it was in the hands of a Muslim horse trader in Midnapur. And a little before that, a little earlier, it belonged to the Bagha Singh family, the traditional feudal elite of Odisha, military aristocracy of Odisha, who owned it because they performed the military role in resisting the Afghans who were constantly attacking Odisha. So within the novel, hardly 150, 160 pages, you have so many displacements, and it hasn't come, the process of displacement hasn't come to an end. At the end of the novel, the Zamindari again passes into the hands of an urban lawyer, Western educated urban lawyer. So what happens? You have four displacements within the same novel. And these displacements illuminate a very profound process. And what is that process? The process is the transition from country to the city. At the beginning, the action was set in a village. We only talked about village chowkidars, a peasant, village moneylenders, women taking bath in a village pond. This was the world. At the end of the novel, you have the law court presided over by an imperious British judge, and then the jail in Cuttack where Ramachandra Mangaraj has been incarcerated, and then he is talking to his lawyer, who may not be an ODI, Ram Ram Lala, for all you know, could be a non-ODI. So actually he's dramatizing a very great, very important, tremendous kind of transition between the country and the city. And not only between land is getting transferred from one section, one elite to another, and something else is also happening about which, or to which, the narrator draws our attention, something the characters themselves would not have drawn our attention. That is language. The shift, the displacement is also taking place at the level of language. At one point, the narrator says that there was a time when Sanskrit was the dominant language. Then it was replaced by Persian. In the novel, the Daroga still writes his report in Persianized Odia. And then in the court, law court, everything is done in English. That's why the narrator says that we Odias don't understand English, our printing presses don't have English letters, so I will engage in tarjama, or translation. I will translate the proceedings, deliberations in the court for the benefit of my own readers. So language, at the level of language, displacement is also taking place. So the narrator, very dominant, garrulous, digressive narrator, who constantly pulls the legs of his readers and tells us how to respond to actions of different characters, how to respond to their motives, how to respond to their decisions. The narrator is constantly drawing our attention to larger historical processes. And he sees it, and he transforms the narrative into an allegory, an anti-colonial allegory. I'll just give you one example, and then I think go on to something else. When the parcel of land, 6 acres and a third, this plot of land, passes into the hands of Ramachandra Mangaraj, this deceitful moneylender cum Jamindar, the narrator pulls back, steps back, and tells us it took less time than it took the Subedari of Bengal and Bihar to pass into the hands of Clive. So he's connecting what is happening in Gobindpur, an insignificant village in Odisha, whatever happened there, to a very large world historical event, the defeat or the passing of Bengal, Bihar, Subedari into the hands of the British after the Palasi War. So throughout the novel, he's constantly, through allusions, carefully placed allusions, deposited carefully in the narrative, he's linking this process of dispossession to the larger dispossession of Indians by the British. For instance, he compares this 6 acres and a third to the Kohinoor diamond. He says that whoever took it, that family got destroyed, or that dynasty got destroyed. This is like poison. But since Lord Shiva can digest poison, only his throat becomes blue when he drinks poison, Bharateswari, the Empress of India, can wear it on her crown. But there is this subtle hint that this novel is about theft. Just as the British stole the diamond, Kohinoor diamond, Ramachandra Mangaraj, Ram Ram Lala, all these people are stealing that plot of land from the poor weaver couple. So we can give many such examples from the novel. The point I was trying to make is that Fakir Mohan is not telling a story. You change the perspective and then you see much larger, much greater, much more important events are unfolding under the surface of a very beautifully, engagingly told story. But Fakir Mohan also does something else in this narrative. We change the, I'll just give on two more perspectives and bring my lecture to an end. One is, he's also, as I told you, in Turgenev, in Dostoevsky, in Tolstoy, you find characters who embody very large processes, historical processes, which ordinarily a sociologist, a historian can't see. So Fakir Mohan is also, like in Robinson Crusoe, he mentions this novel also in his autobiography that he read it. So it's perfectly possible that, like a genius, he could have absorbed this idea from that. He's actually dramatizing, presenting the processes whereby a new kind of man is emerging. The isolated economic man that you found in Robinson Crusoe. A man for whom acquisition is the dominant impulse. Nothing matters. The possessive man, you might have heard of the famous book, Macpherson, the possessive individualism, something like that. So from the 17th century or from the beginning of the Renaissance with the early capitalism, possessive individualism becomes the defining characteristic of society. Man is defined in terms of his possessions, something that he can sell and buy. So when Robinson Crusoe arrives in the island, he gets shipwrecked, the first thing he does, he measures that island. He colonizes it. When he leaves it, he makes sure that other people are there so that they can go on continuing the process of colonization. So Ramachandra Mangaraj is the example of an acquisitive man. Nothing matters to him except acquisition. He's constantly trying to maximize his profit, maximize his possessions at the expense of others. All moral scruples are dispensed with. So the rise of the isolated economic man is another phenomenon which Fakir Mohan could see. No other novelist around that time could perceive this. That is, a new man is emerging on the literary horizon of the social and historical theater. And we can also think of another perspective. You change the perspective, it yields another layer of meaning. It discloses another layer of meaning. There is in the novel, you can call it an eco-critical perspective or an ecological perspective on this novel. Very few people have bothered about that, because Fakir Mohan is not supposed to be a romantic novelist like Kalindi Charan Panigrahi or Hardy, those who actually celebrate nature and all that. But Fakir Mohan does it with far greater finesse, far greater sophistication than all these novelists put together. I'll just draw your attention, those of you who have read this novel, I'll draw your attention to one episode in this novel. In the Darbar of Ramachandra Mangaraj, because he's a village jamindar, so Ramachandra Mangaraj covets the cow, Neta, owned by this poor weaver couple, Bhagya and Sarya. Two Sarya, Bhagya's wife, this who is childless, this poor cow, this white cow, is like her child. The relationship between the two is that of a mother and a daughter. But from the point of view of Ramachandra Mangaraj, so somebody, when somebody asks him, why are you coveting this cow? What is so important about this? He gives this very interesting example. He says that, have you seen a paper mill? A paper mill, you give it grass, you give it rags, put them at one end, and at the other end, you have milk white, paper, sheets of paper coming out. Similarly, you give this grass, give this cow grass or straw, and it gives you 5 sears of milk or 3 sears of white milk, excellent milk. So already, not only land is monetized, not only land is commodified, everything, nature has become property. And the terrible consequences of that affects not just Bhagya and Sarya, but a whole civilization. Only great novelists can do it, others can't see it. So Fakir Mohan was doing this, and as many more perspectives are applied to his fiction, many layers of significance can be disclosed, and our understanding of Fakir Mohan will be deepened and enriched. So thank you very much. I would love to take questions from you if you have them. Okay? So, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for this interesting, informative, and really engaging lecture. And with our sincere gratitude from PG Department of English, Parampur University, for accepting our invitation and giving us this wonderful lecture for so many participants across India. And now I request all the participants to post their questions in the chat box.
Thank you very much, Deepshika.
Because I only saw Aditi Sengupta.
Okay. Sir, there are participants from other countries as well. We have Professor Sushila Gopal from Mauritius. Okay. And I'm seeing some other people also. So throughout there have been, I mean, you know, naturally because of the network, people have been going in and out. But we had consistently about 83 participants. I'm very grateful to the participants. I'm very grateful to you, sir. There are some very important questions that the participants would like to know. There is one question from Mr. Dipankar Jena. His question is, in all the writings of Fakir Mohan Senapati, we find society, land, education and zamindari, etc. But is there any writing describing political scenario of his time? So okay. To say, political writing.
Yeah, very good question. Very good question indeed. Let me tell you that Fakir Mohan was a colonial civil servant. And in the 19th century, under colonial dispensation, you had a very strong censorship. And everything in all courts, in all government offices, you had someone called a translator. So they used to translate whatever news items appeared and So everybody was being closely watched, particularly this newly, this emergent ODI, Western educated ODI elite, was being closely watched by their British masters. So don't think it was easy. For instance, in 1917, which was the centenary year of the Piker Rebellion in Odisha, the newspapers didn't dare celebrate that, dare commemorate that. So, and Radhanath Ray, who is a contemporary of Fakir Mohan, had to throw some of his poems into, I think he was penalized for writing something that spies told the British government were anti-government. So Fakir Mohan, being a past master, I think given his mastery of irony, made sure that all his political views, whatever was politically subversive, was couched in excellent, very subtle irony. So I'll give you an example from Shamana Atgunter, 6 Acres and a Third. He's describing a village pond. He says that, well, there are these birds which are trying to catch a few fish from the mud near the edge of the pond. And you ODIs are like them. And there are some water crows who fly from afar. They come and they catch the best fish and fly away. He actually means the British. So you stupid ODIs, you learn how to swim. Otherwise, you'll go on getting these small fish and all the best fish will be taken by these foreign crows. So he was very careful when he expressed his political views, which are very subversive. This novel, as I just described, is an anti-colonial allegory. So he was extremely careful and has to present them through excellent irony. So he didn't dare do that in a very obvious way. I hope that this answers your question.
Thank you, sir. There is a question from a student. She asks you, Sonalika Das, she asks you why Fakir Mohan Senapati has used various kinds of language like English, Urdu, and etc. in 6 Acres and a Third when he loved his mother tongue, Odia.
Okay, this very notion of mother tongue is very problematic. When we speak Odia, we actually use many Persian words, many English words, many Hindi words. So this idea of a standard Odia language, in all this, is a pan-Indian phenomenon. Oh, after independence, after states were formed on the basis of language, linguistic states came into being, I think most languages became Sanskritized. So it's impossible for us now to go back and find out how polyglot we were. Our language was papered with Persian words, with Bengali, with Hindi, just as other languages were also mixed with many other languages. So there is nothing called a pure Odia. So Fakir Mohan actually is dramatizing or expressing the heteroglossia, that actually we spoke so many languages. Our language wasn't pure, within quotes. And a pure language is very boring language. We become less and less creative when we try to sanitize our language. This is a very loaded word given the context of the pandemic. So if you sanitize your language, then you take out much that is vibrant, much that is very lively from your language. Fakir Mohan came from Balasur, he learned Persian, he was fluent in Bangla, he was teaching himself Telugu, and he knew Hindi, he knew Sanskrit, he knew Urdu. We are all, I think, reflexively multilingual in India. So each language is penetrated by other languages. So that's why Chaman Atman is so exciting. And books written recently in chaste ODIs are so boring. So I hope that answers your question. That when he wrote, Odia was actually an amalgam of many, many elements, many linguistic elements, and which is a good thing.
Thank you so much, sir. There is a question related to the earlier question, the political question. So, how do Fakir Mohan's writings reflect the ideological, social, cultural, political, and deeper emotional interactions between the colonized and the colonizer?
Will you please repeat that? I just lost you for a minute. Yeah.
How do his writings reflect the ideological, social, cultural, political, and deeper emotional interactions between the colonized and the colonizer?
Yes, again, a very, very good question. Difficult to answer, but I'll try. I distinguish between a sociologist or a historian and a creative writer. Fakir Mohan worked at many levels. He didn't offer simple binaries. That the colonizers are good, bad, the colonized are good. That the Bengalis are bad, the Odias are good. If you read his fiction, he talks of colonization at several levels. For instance, take Chomana Arthagunt, and he is not only criticizing the colonizers, he's also criticizing an ossified, static, stagnant social order that the Odias have created for themselves. For instance, the way he satirizes the Brahmins who have lost all their learning. There is this famous Samtihadi. He's talking about Samtihadi, Tripathi. That Bilare Chipanti Mina, he actually catches fish and has forgotten his Vedas. He is very critical of the Bhagat Singh family. Think of Bhagat Singh family. How cruel they are towards their own daughter-in-law. They're superstitious. This villainess goes to their house, burns the house down, and they punish their daughter-in-law. And they believed only in the power of human muscles. So you can see that he is against colonization of all kinds, not just the British colonization. That's why I told you his response to Western education is very highly complex and nuanced and layered. He says that, well, you can oppress your own people. You don't need colonizers to do that. So he's talking about complex negotiations. He understands that history means change. Change means transformation. And transformation has pleasant and unpleasant aspects to it. And he has to dramatize this negotiation, a highly complex negotiation. And there are no simple heroes and villains. So that's what literature does for us, so that we don't look for simple answers. We always look for complex, many-layered responses to a situation. I hope that goes some way towards answering that question.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there is a question that Fakir Mohan Senapati is often called the Thomas Hardy of Odisha. Why is he called so?
Well, Dr. Mayadhar Mansingh calls him the Thomas Hardy of Odisha, and Dr. Bolton, British critic of Fakir Mohan, calls him the Dickens. I think it's better to call him Thomas. I think both are right and both are wrong. He is closer to Thomas Hardy because he's talking about the disintegration of the agrarian world. Okay, under British rule, like now, think of the farmers' agitation now, the farmers' bill in the parliament. We are talking about the disintegration of the rural world, the agrarian world. So Fakir Mohan is talking about that, and so did Thomas Hardy. Okay, the relationship to man and nature is being disrupted. That's one. But Thomas Hardy didn't have Fakir Mohan's humor. The vibrant humor that characterizes Fakir Mohan's fiction is conspicuous in its absence, by its absence in Thomas Hardy. So there you are reminded of Charles Dickens, the irreverent humor, the liveliness of Dickens's characterization, the way the narrator makes fun of. So you can see that he shares characteristics with both Hardy and Dickens, but I think the world he depicts, the world he presents to us, is closer to Hardy's than to Dickens, because Dickens is presenting an industrialized world, the city, whereas Fakir Mohan confines himself to the disintegrating rural world. So, well, this is both right and wrong.
Thank you so much, sir. One more question on his novels or writings. How can we compare the writings of Fakir Mohan Senapati with that of other contemporary writers like Munshi Premchand in relation to the representation of peasants and the zamindari system in India? And after that, there is a question on Rebati.
Okay. I think whenever we compare one great writer with another, we have to be very careful. Sometimes the similarities are less important than the differences. But when you put them side by side, they illuminate each other. And you must keep one major difference in mind. Premchand comes maybe, I think, some 20 years later than, I don't know the exact date, but he is not a contemporary of Fakir Mohan. And in Premchand's fiction, you find a negotiation between Urdu and Hindi, and also he's far more openly, overtly anti-colonial than Fakir Mohan Senapati. He was very partial to the freedom struggle. He was deeply influenced by Gandhi, whereas Fakir Mohan was, I think, he didn't live long enough to respond to the freedom struggle. He talks about only his meeting with Bal Gangadhar Tilak in Voltaire. So these are the differences which we have to keep in mind when you put them together. But both were talking about the condition of the peasant in a world dominated by very oppressive land revenue administration. So when you compare them, and comparisons should always take details into account. So Godan and Shamanart, one has to place them alongside each other and see where they differ and where they resemble each other. So this is a very large question, and I can't give a very satisfactory answer off the cuff. Okay. But as I told you, they share many similarities, but these concerns are different because Premchand belongs to another period and his anti-colonialism is far more pronounced. It doesn't have to be covert and coded like that of Fakir Mohan. So the differences are extremely important, but both are dealing with a disintegrating rural world in India. So one can compare them profitably with each other. Yes, the question.
Thank you, sir. A question from Professor Savita Tripathi. Why all the characters die in his novels, especially short story Repati?
Well, I think for a very long time, we have been dealing with Repati, thanks to the feminists in Odisha or elsewhere, as a story of a young girl's aspiration or desire to get educated, to receive education or modern education. If you read, I think in many new editions, in the first edition of the story, the first version of the story which got published in the last half of the, I think, in the closing decade of the 19th century, there was an epigraph which no story features now, no version of Repati features now. And that epigraph from a British poet or some Scottish poet, I don't remember exactly, talks about the fragility of life, the unpredictability of life. It doesn't talk about education. And in any case, Fakir Mohan wrote its criticism, because in those days, criticism of fiction wasn't at a very high level. It was just beginning to strike roots in Odisha. So the writer himself wrote a review of his own story in Utkal Sahitya under a pseudonym. And there he actually doesn't talk about education. He talks about the sudden deaths of so many characters. So during the pandemic, actually Fakir Mohan is talking about a highly vulnerable world where life was so short that whole families could be wiped out, that you could never take life for granted. So he's presenting the fragility of life under colonial rule. I think Professor Kalidas Mishra is now working on this. So I think he'll give a better answer than this. But we should now change our perspective on Repati and look at it as Fakir Mohan's covert criticism of the colonial order. He was a witness to the 1866 famine. He had seen how under colonial rule, there were a series of famines and life was so uncertain. Like, in fact, Shashi Bhushan Rai, in one of his articles in Utkal Sahitya, said that how come highly educated people live for such a short life? I think the pressure of jobs was so heavy that people would die quickly. So the fragility of life, the kind of uncertainty that everyone faced, cholera, malaria later actually wiped out whole villages. So there was a very bleak prospect unfolding before the writers, people who were conscious, people who have stopped becoming fatalist. Earlier, people thought that, well, people died because their life ran out. Okay, the gods wanted to take them to themselves. But a modern education made these people question that kind of fatalism and ask why people are so vulnerable, people are so fragile, their lives are so fragile and uncertain under a dispensation which calls itself scientifically advanced, which calls itself better than the Maratha rule and Mughal rule, and people are dying like flies. So I think we should look at Revati from this perspective, and I hope Professor Das, Professor Mishra will illuminate this aspect of the story. Thank you for asking this question.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Mary Mahanty has a similar question. I think you have answered it already. How fragile is related to colonialism?
I'll just add one sentence to answer Dr. Mahanty. That is, if you look back at colonial rule, when we became independent in 1947, the lifespan, the average lifespan, the longevity of every Indian was only 32 years, and literacy was only 12%, and there was a series of famines in 1866, in 1943, between the two, another 10 famines. One thing we have eliminated after independence is famine. There is hunger, but no famine. So under colonialism, life was fragile and uncertain. Let's face that. Because we are Western educated and our minds are colonized, we always think that the British rule was a wonderful period. But it was a period in which many crores of Indians died during famines. Whole villages got wiped out because of malaria. You read autobiographies and you will find out. Okay?
Thank you, sir. There is a question that Bengal provided the first crop of rural novels in English. Yeah. Can Fakir Mohan Senapati's fiction be compared to any of these writers?
Of course, I just gave the example of Bengal peasant life, and Fakir Mohan was an avid reader of Bankim Chandra's novels. Nilakantha Das says that whenever a Bankim novel was published, Fakir Mohan was very restless and he wanted to read. And you know that Fakir Mohan translated Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar's biographical sketches. So he knew Bengali literature of that time like the back of his hand. And there is a suggestion that Visabrukhya by Bankim Chandra exercised a deep influence on Fakir Mohan Chamana Atagund. And Lachama, obviously Bankim Chandra wrote a lot of historical romances. But Fakir Mohan, being a genius, transformed all the influences he observed and completely rewrote them and created something outstandingly different. And why we didn't write novels, Bankim Chandra himself wrote a novel, Rajmohan's Wife, in English and got sick of it and wrote enriched Bengali literature. So since they had a very rich mother tongue, they didn't need to write in English. Okay, so I will answer that question by saying that, well, in Turkey, for instance, in Japan, nobody writes in English. Turkey, there is no Turkish literature in English or Japanese literature in English. It's only in ex-colonies like India that we feel compelled to write novels in English when we have rich mother tongues in which we can write. And if the writing is great, it can be translated and transform the world.
Thank you, sir. This is the last question. Can we initiate a debate on center margin and self-other dichotomy in his writings?
Of course you can, because every new perspective will yield greater insights. But we should rise above or transcend these binaries. The self is also implicated in the other. The other is part of ourself. And the center, today's center becomes tomorrow's margin. And today's victim becomes tomorrow's oppressor. So something like that we must keep in mind when we deal with these binaries. These can be dangerous, can circumscribe and narrow our perspectives. As long as we keep this in mind, we can use all these perspectives in Fakir Mohan to our advantage.
Thank you so much, sir. I thought that this would be the last question, but there is a question from one of our PG first year students, and I cannot dishearten her. She is asking you, can we see character like Mangaraj in today's society? If yes, then what has changed in our society till now?
Well, I think sometimes we say we change, at the same time remain the same. There is something called continuity and change, and continuity in change. So we have Mangaraja. Just I gave you the example of the farmers' agitation today, that the rural world is again in turmoil. It has been in turmoil. With not a single novelist after Fakir Mohan Senapati, after Premchand, after maybe other novelists in the after independence, we haven't got a single writer who writes about the rural world anymore. We have all become cityfied. But that doesn't mean that moneylenders have disappeared. They have appeared in other guises, certain, but the techniques have become different. So there is something called social persistence. There is change, but things also persist. The past is never past. The past is not completely dead. So in many ways, we can always find parallels between the past and the present, and the future will also be controlled by tendencies that emerged during the past. So we can never live in a world where there is a complete break with the past, complete break between the present and the future, because they're all intimately interconnected. And there will always be Ramachandra Mangaras, but he might be wearing a pinstripe, and he might be wearing a tie. He might be working in a bank. He might be working in a... So you never know. But that's why I told you of the emergence of the isolated economic man. We have all become Ramachandra Mangarajas in a way. We have become acquisitive individuals. We have become possessive individualists. So Ramachandra Mangaraj thrives, but he has grown more sophisticated. His techniques are very, very refined, and his victims have also changed. So we can't. So the world remains, the world changes, and in many respects remains the same, and sometimes reverts to the past, like we have now during the pandemic.
Thank you, sir. I hope, Pragya, your question is answered. Sir, as I was going to say that we'd end the session, there is a question from N. Suman Shelley. Would you like to take it? One more question.
Yes. At least some people heard me. So.
I know lots of them did. So Senapati's concept of space is very well exhibited through the character Santani and he and the ways of protest in 6 acres and a third. She has just spoken once throughout the novel. She knew her space, and her silence was a powerful medium of protest. So, do you think that Senapati was a feminist? Because he was he has very cleverly dealt with that aspect.
I think this will be it will be anachronistic to call Fakir Mohan a feminist, but he did create some very powerful female characters, very powerful women characters. And Santani, through her presence, I think exerted a lot of influence. She might not have been able to defeat Champa. She might not have been able to change the course of action of Mangaras, but she is a powerful presence. Even after her death, there is a very moving description of a farmhand who is mourning her death. So sometimes I think even when we don't do anything, our very presence can have an influence on society, on people around us. So only aggression is not the only way in which things change, or our attitudes towards life change. Change can take a very long time and can be a very long drawn out process. So by creating a character who was so good, so kind, so compassionate, and silently protest against evil, I think Fakir Mohan has created an unforgettable and memorable character. So even after you rise from a reading of the text, you mourn her. So that's one way of looking at. And the other very strong character, female character, some of them are evil, like Champa. So Fakir Mohan is creating a highly complex world which cannot be interpreted or defined only in terms of black and white, where there are victims, there are oppressors, there are characters who are helpless. So he's presenting a world, and the world is a complex one, and we can't just divide these characters into groups, very convenient groups. So I would say that we may not call him a feminist, but he has created very, very memorable, unforgettable, and sometimes very strong and powerful women characters. So a great writer lives through his characters. So if he has created a character who has stirred you, he has already succeeded. Whether Santani succeeded or not, we know that she didn't succeed. But I think Fakir Mohan created a succeeded in creating a memorable and unforgettable female character. I think that would be my answer. It may not be a satisfactory one, but that's the best I can offer.
Thank you very much, sir. You've been speaking for more than 1 hour now. I think it's nearly 7 o'clock, it's 6:50. So I guess you must be very tired.
So I hope I will survive and my listeners will survive as well.
Thank you so much. I will request my colleague, Dr. Varavadra Tripathi, to propose a formal vote of thanks. We thank you from the core of our hearts, sir, for keeping our request.
Thank you, Dr. Das. On behalf of the department, I extend a very warm vote of thanks to Professor Jatin Naik, who has really gave a very wonderful and very brilliant talk on Fakir Mohan's fictional world. He touched almost all the perspectives of Fakir Mohan's writings. Our students must be highly enlightened, and our colleagues must be highly helped by his talk. And as we were going through the talk, listening to the talk very carefully, we found that Professor Naik touched on Fakir Mohan's art of characterization, his narrative technique, how the powerful narrator was pulling at the legs of the readers. That was quite interesting. And present from the traditional worldview to the modern worldview. So all these areas which occupy the conception of the modern fictional world and how Fakir Mohan was expecting many new things that happened in today's world. Also, he talked about Fakir Mohan's characterization, his characterization of women, characterization of the powerful characters, the landowner, the social realities of that time, his sense of humor, more importantly, he talked about that. So thank you, Professor Naik, for giving such an exhaustive talk on Fakir Mohan's writings. We really enjoyed it. Our students and colleagues, myself, we got highly benefited by your talk. Thank you so much. I thank my colleagues and professors from different departments from inside India as well as from abroad. I thank my students, my scholars for coming in large number in listening to this talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So should we say goodbye? Like the Americans, we hate to say goodbye, but we have to say goodbye.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Jatin sir. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I don't know, I don't have words. My students wanted to hear you so much. And then there were other colleagues and then, teachers of our affiliated colleges who went on telling me, please invite Jatin sir. We want to listen to him. We want to hear about him talking on Fakir Mohan Senapati. And thank you so much for accepting my invitation at such a short notice.
All right, it was my pleasure. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.